solid growth economics, in our experience, rely on four elements, and then we're going to sort of dissect them. Two of them have to do with market and product. So you have, you're targeting a big market, which is great. You know, if there's no big market, there's no venture. The second bit that we need to talk about is product to market fit. And product to market fit is also something that a lot of us have different conceptions about it. The one we like to believe is very simplistic in a way, which is, was I able to sell what I'm doing to someone that I don't have a relation with? That's basically the ultimate market fit. There is actually someone out there willing to buy what I'm doing. So the product to market fit is about, you know, is this actually flying? Are actually people buying this? Not, you know, the friends and family and people that have relationships or members of the board and or investors, but actually real people that I don't have any relation with. They see the product, they understand what the benefits are, they're willing to pay a gazillion dollars for it because they've been waiting for that all their lives. Then, okay, so I have the fundamentals. And then we're gonna try to build on that, on the engine. How am I gonna extract value from this? And there's essentially two things. Can I create a growth engine? And this is about, this is where your reputation comes in and how you build a reputation. I'm able to build a growth engine. If I build a growth engine on my venture here, and if I exit it, I can build a growth engine somewhere else. It doesn't matter what it is because growth engines behave in the same way. So a growth engine is the mechanisms by which you're gonna acquire, nurture, and explore the relations of value with your clients. And the finally, the unit economics. Unit economics, you're all familiar with unit economics, right? So the only thing about unit economics is, and perhaps you've had other talks about it, is how you calculate it. Make sure that you don't go into the fallacy of, oh, my unit economics, I'm not working, let me change the Excel sheet. It doesn't work like that. How do unit economics not work? So unit economics, very simple thing. Total cost of acquisition and maintenance. So how much do I spend acquiring customers, but also how much does it cost me to service them? And actually, when we were building this, one of the examples we have is one of our clients who was, you know, a transformation client, not a scale up. So digital transformation that we came into just, you know, recreate growth in that client. And that client, it's very interesting because they were not calculating their unit economics properly because they didn't count the cost of servicing a customer and acquiring a customer properly because simply they didn't add the costs of marketing and or the call center. You know, all the unit economics were perversed because that cost was not accounted correctly. So first bit is make sure you put everything in there. The other thing that people fail to put in there is the cost of people. So the cost of the salaries that you actually spend on your marketing team and your service, client services team or client success, whatever that is, or even support because things are not working. Just make sure that everything is accounted for. Normally on this, on unit economics calculations on a startup or a scale-up, pretty much the only cost that doesn't go in anywhere is the founders because that's the only thing that's kind of, you know, you helicopter over everything, so it's very difficult to allocate. Then everything else, you know, total cost of producing and servicing products, projected number of units sold, all of that, you know, is you calculate, and then you get into a profit per product unit, whatever that product unit is. So installations of on a browser and or downloads of the application that allows me to monitor that or a game installation, whatever that is. Whatever your unit is, you calculate the cost of that. When you calculate the cost of it, you can then manage growth scenarios. And this is a growth scenario looking at revenue. You show, basically, you show this, you have a, you know, a customer acquisition scenario and the revenue, and it all says, this is, you know, the fairy tale. It all looks good. You're like, yeah, it all looks great. You know, if I'm an investor and look at this and they say, oh, that's great, you know, conservative, realistic, ambitious. Like, okay, you know, let's go with, you know, the middle there, that's what's going to happen. When you then apply unit economics into the rationale, what happens is that, you know, the worst case scenario is like, just get away from it. The realistic scenario, actually, you're not going to make any money. And it only, you know, in the wishful thinking that you're actually going to make any money. So if you're an investor, you're not going to invest in this. But showing the numbers, looking at the numbers yourself, it's going to produce a lot of credibility, A, when you show it to investors. B, you're going to be able to manage the variables that actually compose that unit economics cost. So basically, you're going to be focusing on managing the business, which is a great thing. You're going to be, especially if you're bootstrapping, going to be looking at, shoot, you know, how can I improve this? How am I going to lower my cost of acquisition of clients and servicing of clients? Do I have self-servicing, for example? You know, I'm not going to use this type of channel of acquisition because it's just too expensive. Well, I'm going to explore the other one. The cost of producing a certain product, you know, maybe it's just not feasible right now. I'm going to push that back for another 6 months. I'm going to focus on this product alone and try to grow on that. And then maybe the other one will be an upsell, whatever that is. So what I want to get to is, unless you're able to adequately frame your unit economics, it's very hard to build a credible growth scenario.